So, I have recently changed my name. I've given a number of webinars here at MBS Bioscience, but I am no longer Susan Hendricks. So, my new name is Susan Tappan. And I'm staff scientist here at MBS, just like Dan, but I also have a role in MBS Labs, which is our contract research organization. And both Dan and I are intensely interested in seriology as a quantification method.
And that's why we're going to talk to you today about seriology concepts and fold selection.
As always, we love hearing from you both during the webinar and after. So please submit your questions via the question window, and we're going to address them as we go along. This webinar is being recorded and will be available for viewing later.
Okay, so the purpose of today's webinar, this is really not a beginner webinar for seriology. We're not going to go over things like how to follow the rules and how much sampling to do. We do have other webinars about that, and we can help you out with that type of thing. Today's webinar is kind of just a step back from that, and we want to kind of demystify the process of choosing the seriological probe. We want to give you our advice, tell you our favorite probes, and what probes we think you should be using that are the easiest and the most efficient to use.
Yeah, so we're really going to be covering seriology from an experimental design perspective. So prior to sitting down at the microscope and getting going, what do you need to think about and how it's the best way to approach your experimental design. So here's the problem. You want to be able to quantify three-dimensional structures. And that could be anything from the number of marbles in a jar to Christelle and Jean-Claude's how much fabric they had to use in order to wrap these beautiful trees in their art installation. So that would be an example of a surface area quantification.
It'd be a volume. Somebody might want to know the volume. That's also, yeah. Here's an odd-shaped figure. It's a star. How can we estimate the volume or maybe the surface area of this solid?
If you're hungry, I mean, it is lunchtime here on the East Coast, so how much spaghetti I have in my dish, and by how much I mean how long, if I put those strands end to end to end, how long would my spaghetti stretch?
That's one type of thing that needs to be estimated. Here we have our loaf of marble rye. And it has two components in it, and somebody may want to know what is the volume of one of those components, or what's the surface area of one of those components. So we should try to show you examples from real life of the types of features that we estimated, but we're going to be working under the microscope.
Right, and so if you take this conceptual understanding of these features that you want to quantify and then apply them to our lives as scientists, we may be interested in quantifying, say, the volume of the cortex or how many neurons there are in the cerebellum.
Sue and I are both neuroscientists, so we tend to do the brain a lot, but obviously seriology can be used in any organ. You may be interested in something about the blood supply to the heart, so the blood from the capillaries may be of interest. There's a lot of membranes that biologists are interested in. What's the surface area, for instance, the maternal fetal interface in the placenta?
Right. And so we're going to be discussing all of these in the framework of how do you estimate these 3D parameters on tissue sections, so when you can't observe your entire parameter in its entirety just by looking at any needed section of them.
So the solution to the problem, you think, is unbiased seriology.
Absolutely. On the right is one of my favorite cartoons, FKTV, and this one just makes me giggle when I see it, because it illustrates the difference between, say, a normal person and a scientist. So you get shot, pull the lever, and if you're a scientist, you might say, huh, I wonder if that happens every time. So we're really interested in approaching these types of phenomena as a way to understand. We want to understand what are the rules that govern how things work. And so in order to approach that, we want to design experiments that allow us to tease apart those rules or those concepts that lead to the events that we're looking to understand. And so we want to be able to show that a stimulus produces a result over and over and over again, and that is reproducibility.
And if you use unbiased stereology, there'll be a set of rules that you need to follow. And the rules are not that hard. We're not going to go into all the rules for all the probes, but we do have other sources to help you with that. That will get you an unbiased estimate. If you follow these rules so the bias doesn't creep into your sampling, you also need to think about how much to sample, and that's where the precision comes in. And if you can be unbiased by following the rules and do the right amount of sampling, you get the precision, like Sue says, you can get reproducibility. The precision and the rules for bias are not going to be the main focus of this talk. What we're going to try to do is let you know how to pick a probe, which one to use.
Right, and stereology is a great quantification method because they were making no assumptions of the size, shape, orientation, or distribution of your bleacher of interest. And so that really removes that concern that the way that you're looking at your object or your feature is in some way having an impact on the efficacy.
Okay, so what do we mean by probes? A stereology probe is a shape, a geometrical shape, and a set of rules that guide you in using that shape to you throw the probe down in the tissue, and what we want to do is count events. We want to count the interaction of the probe with the feature that we're trying to quantify.
And so if you are interested in quantifying volume, we'll represent the countable event by the number of points that intersect with your with the volume of interest.
So in that case, the event is the point over the area in the volume, which we show on the left there. Closer volume. Now, if you're looking for how much area do you have, what you want to estimate the surface area, we can use the line to we can count the intersections of the area that you're trying to quantify with the line that you're probing with. The more events or the more intersections of the probing line with the surface, the more surface there is. If we work our way right again and above the picture of the spaghetti, is an example of how we could use planes, segments of planes, to probe for events. So we put the planes down, that's the geometrical shape you're probing for. We count the intersections of the string, that could be a fiber or a blood vessel, whose length we're trying to estimate. The more events or intersections you get, the longer the strings are. When you're looking for numbers of particles, what we're going to do is find a deep point on the particle, and so we're going to be using a volume to probe for the number of points that are there. And so this is what we mean by stereology, close to the shapes that you probe with and the rules that you follow with the
eyes. Right, so to employ stereology, we've got these probes, but we also need to determine how these probes, how often we're going to come across the quantification we're going to be doing. And in order to actually estimate the feature that you're interested in, we rely on systematic random sampling because we do not want to have to visit every aspect of our region or our feature of interest. Instead, what we want to do is we want to do it on a subfraction so that we're efficient. But we need to do it in a way that ensures a lack of bias and provides consistent sampling.
I think another way to say this is we don't want to take just one section through the middle of the region and look only at that. We want to systematically and randomly section all the way through the region, both on an animal level, we see with the sections on the left. And once the section is picked, the XY area should be sampled systematically and randomly. We want to give every section an equal chance of being picked, and every corner of that section an equal chance of being sampled. All of the probes we're going to recommend today need to be used with systematic random sampling.
Yeah, and there are other sampling methods that are in use with stereologic probes, like the fractionator, for example. So there are other ways to perform your sampling, but they will be used in conjunction with a probe in order to quantify your feature of interest.
So systematic random sampling is important in stereology. That kind of gets at where you're looking for, but we also want to talk about where you're looking. So how is that probe, which remember is that geometrical shape, how is that probe going to interact with the feature whose number or length or surface or volume that you're trying to estimate? And we have to think about isotropy. And our definition here likelihood of, for example, we want to demand three dimensional space.
Right, we're going to achieve that.